Are in chapter 2 on Newton's first law of motion, inertia. I covered most of it, but I'll finish today and start chapter 3 on linear motion. Remind you that in WebAssign you have two homework assignments that started when class started, an intro about the syllabus and logistics. Hopefully you're finding that one easy. And the second one on what we've been covering this week, chapter 1 and chapter 2. Those are due Sunday night. Doesn't mean you can't complete them as soon as this class is over or anytime you feel like you have the answers. I actually encourage you not to wait till the last minute, because if WebAssign goes down and you can't submit, it's your fault. Sort of. Contact me if it happens, because that's not good of WebAssign. It should tell you whether you got the answer right or not, or wrong.
No, like at the very bottom of the
script. Oh, no, it doesn't. Yeah, I don't like it. I would prefer a big splash screen that says, oh, yes, yeah, submitting successfully. Very good. Thank you very much. It doesn't. Yeah. So you should know if you got it wrong as soon as you submit. And then you can see what's right. Once it's due, so after Sunday night, you can go back and view the answer key. Granted, I can see if you view the answer key. Thus, if for some reason you want to say, oh, you know, there's no late homework, but some people, they come to me anyway, or you have an accident, or you know, something, and can I please, please, please make it up? I go in. You've already looked at the answer key, silly. No. But I do want you to look at the answer key once you've submitted it. You're done. Because then I have some explanations, and you can make sure you got the right answers. And see if you have any confusions, because then you can ask me about those in class or not.
For like the number 15 and number 16, the question number 15 and 16 in homework 2, it asked me to just calculate the gravity, so I'm not sure the number. Should we use it? It's 9.8.
So you haven't checked your email since last night?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
He
sent me several, so I figured you were going to respond. 9.8. I build a tolerance. There's a default tolerance in the answer. For example, say the if you use 9.8, you get it right. If you use 9.81, you still get it right. I tried 9.8 and it gave an answer with a decimal. I dropped the decimal, it's still right. So there's a bit of tolerance. If you put in 10, you miss it. That's too far off.
Because I couldn't wait last night, so I just tried 9.8. I got the right answer.
Couldn't wait, huh? Even though it's due Sunday. Okay. Well, good. You found out. But yeah, 9.8 is more accurate, yes. I won't lie. On a test, if you use 9.8 or 10, you'll get it right because it's multiple choice, and I won't have any that close together. I try to make the math easier on a test. Doesn't mean you still don't want to, might want a calculator, but generally, you don't even have to do math on most of my questions. So, but yeah, when you have to actually put in a value, 9.8. Conceptually, it's easier to think about 10 if you just want to see what's going on, because we can do multiples of 10 in our head. This is good. Raise your hand if you think of something else. All righty. How do you define inertia? Resistance to movement?
Resistance to change?
Resistance of changing movement. How about that? Does that mean change in motion? I can think of two ways to do that. What would those be? Your state of motion.
Velocity and direction.
Velocity and direction. Good. Yeah, my question was open-ended. It was a little vague. But that's good. You can change it two ways. The magnitude, which we call speed, by the way. This is chapter 3. Speed is just magnitude. It's called a scalar. These are defined in your chapter. A scalar just has magnitude. That's speed. Velocity includes direction also. So it's speed, magnitude, and direction. So it's speed with a direction. That's called a vector. Vector includes both. Scalar, just magnitude. Another example, force. You know, an influence that causes a change in motion is a vector. So you get how strong it is, the magnitude, but also it matters which direction, as we started showing last lecture, because you can have somebody pushing this way and somebody pushing this way. And it's that direction matters. The net effect will be the difference between the two, right? If this is 20 and this is 5, what's the net? 15. And now that you're using vectors properly, it's a force, it's a vector. You would say it's 15 units to your left, right? Or west. Or that way, yeah, with a direction. Magnitude is just the value. So there's values to force, speed, velocity, brightness, loudness, and those are all magnitudes. If a direction is also included, then it's a vector. So brightness is just how bright the star is. It doesn't make sense to say it's this many foot candles to the north. Is that brightness? I get confused. I always forget luminosity versus brightness versus, anyway. Another example is acceleration. But that's a vector. It has a magnitude and direction, because you can accelerate that way or that way. That's important. Good. So inertia is a resistance to change. Oh, what I was getting at anyway was a change of motion. If you're at rest, that's your state of motion, not moving, no velocity, no acceleration. So if you start moving, you've changed it. But also, if you're already moving, but at a constant velocity, you're not changing your motion, you're just being consistent. So if you're not changing, there's no net acceleration on you, or you'd be changing. So that's another way to look at your change of motion. Good. All right. Let's do some more force body diagrams, because the term I didn't get to was mechanical equilibrium. We discussed it, but there's a term for it. So let me make up something here. Did I make up one here? Sort of. This isn't nice, and I'm being recorded, but there's an older gentleman that teaches in this lecture every once in a while, and let's just say he has lots of physical things holding him back, and I have a better appreciation for him now using these boards. All right, our author was a painter, if you've been reading the chapter at all, and so he worked a lot on these platforms, cleaning windows and painting. And he had a good friend that taught him. Whoop. And so he uses a lot of these examples in your book. So you're out on a platform that can go up and down on the side of a building. Help me. What are some forces you can think of? I'm going to start drawing them. Gravity. Good. Acting on... Yeah, well, let's look at the objects individually then. So this person has what we call weight. I mean, you know what weight is. It's different than mass. We're going to get into this more, but you need to know it now. Mass is a property of matter, how much you're made up of. But the earth pulling down on us gives us our weight. So weight is a force. And the way you find it is mass times gravity. This is really an acceleration. This is the next chapter. It's an acceleration because Earth is accelerating us downward at a certain rate, trying to change our motion. It has a certain value, so we call it, we just say G. And G is 9.8 meters per second squared. And that'll make more sense in chapter 3. Maybe by the end of this lecture, hopefully. But I want you to realize weight is a force. And it's caused by gravity. So this guy has a weight. We'll call it force 1. This guy has a weight. Let's say he's bigger. Force 2. See, the length of my arrows represent magnitude, so you can get an idea. But there's also the platform. It weighs something. It has mass. So there's three forces of just due to gravity on these objects. Now, you don't want this to fall, so what else has to be going on? Say it again.
Tension
in the strings. Tension is a force. We're going to discuss lots of forces in this class. They come in different varieties. We find them different ways. But they're all a force that we're learning about. They cause a change in motion. And so this rope is holding you up. What am I on? 4? And this one. And they may be the same. They may not. Yeah, those are tensions. So there's other forces. Now, if you're not moving, you're not falling, your motion isn't changing, what can you tell me about these forces?
They balance out.
They balance out. They're equal. Very good. So your book calls that mechanical equilibrium. And they use this symbol, if it's new to you. It's the Greek letter sigma, which means summation. You add up all the forces. And if you add all of them up and they equal zero, you're in equilibrium. Balance. There's no change in motion. There's no net force. That's what I prefer that. Net, the net force is zero. Thus, there's no influence trying to change our motion. Our inertia is, you know, winning out. So, the fact that they're vectors, this is how I'd write that. I can just do it over here. Sum up these forces. We have F4 is up. Generally, up is positive and to the right is positive. It's convention. You can make it whatever you want as long as you're consistent and don't change it during the same problem. But typically, up and to the right are positive. So let's add that to a positive F5. Those are the two going up. And then we have 3 going down. So that's where that direction comes into play. And you could add all those up. Now, that was the longhand way. Some of you are going, why'd you do all that? Yes, you can just write this. Same thing. So you can find things out. I don't know. I'm going to make up some numbers here. Let's see. How heavy is the plank? I'm not going to give you this one. But if he weighs 200 pounds, and he weighs 150 pounds, then the tension here, let's say, is 200, and this one is 300. Let's see if I flubbed up. Okay, so we have 500 up. Do you see that? Nod or something. 500 up. What do we got down? 350? Okay, so what's the difference? 500 minus 350. £150, right? Must be the weight of the plank. You can figure out all kinds of things this way. It's fun. Now, does that make sense? This is called resolving forces. We've drawn a force body diagram. Figure out everything that's going on. And then think to yourself. You need to reason. Okay, they're not falling, so these must balance this. Oh, we're in equilibrium. There's no net force. We're not accelerating. Our motion isn't changing. You can figure all this out. So then he likes to discuss in the book, let's say this person walks over to here and is now over here. How do things change? Or do they? You think the tension will change? How so? Yeah, see, there's a lot of common sense in physics. I hope you can see this. If you walk over here, this one has to hold you up more, doesn't it? So I would expect this tension to go up. If that's true, which it is, very good. What do you think happens over here? It'll go down because the total up still balances the total down. We haven't changed the totals. Do you see that? We're still in mechanical equilibrium, but we've shifted the workload among the rope, if you will. Does that make sense? Okay. I think I gave you a problem. Let's see. You got some rings. Whee! Okay. Yeah. The Olympics are coming up. I know it's winter, but you can think of that. So here, if I told you this person's mass, then I could ask you, what's the tension in one side of the rings? You know, in this rope. You now have enough info to figure this out. So think a moment. Yeah.
M by 2 into M
by 2. Just repeat that.
M divided by 2 into multiplied by 9.8.
M divided by 2. I think you're right. Let's back up. Good. I want to show the step so everybody has it. Tell me how you thought that through, because you jumped to the end, and you're right. Very good. Okay, good. There's one step. Since it looks symmetric, yeah, it's balanced. And so it is fair to assume that the tension here is the same there. They're going to share the workload. Very good. Continue. Good. Another step I want to emphasize. Mass is not a force. Weight is. So let's figure out this person's weight. Okay, done. And so, yeah, you have a weight down, and these up. So if they're in mechanical equilibrium, just hanging there, then these two must add up to the magnitude of this one. And can you see then each one of these will be half the weight of the person. Now, what if instead of like this, they go, this one's going to have to hold her up more, right? The totals don't change, but the tension will be greater on one side than the other. And you would need trigonometry to figure that out with the angle, and we're not doing that in this class. But you conceptually, you know it's going to get bigger. I mean, if think of the extreme where you're completely on this one and let go. Well, then, yeah, that one has to hold your whole weight up because you're not even using that one. Or vice versa. Let's do another one. How about you got a block and you pull on it, if you will. You know, I've always wanted to improve my stick figure drawings, but it hasn't happened yet. Okay, you're pulling. All right, I'm interested in the motion of this block horizontally. So what's the first thing I should do? What should I consider? Anything? Tell me what comes to mind. What do you think is going to matter?
Friction.
Good, okay. Which direction is friction? Friction's a force. Point, yeah, if you think you know which way. I'm seeing a few people point, and those that are pointing are right, so the rest of you can cheat and look at them. Friction resists your change. So if this person's pulling that way, friction is in between the surfaces. And the reason it happens isn't as important. But basically, microscopically, you're trying to like move atoms, or there's attractions between them and repulsions. And so there's a force there. And basically, it's just what you think. It's trying to keep you from moving in the direction you're trying to. So if we're trying to move this block to the right, friction is in between the surface and the block to the left. And it's a force trying to change the motion. Now I'll give you the obvious. I'm pulling this way. So there's your horizontal forces. And if we're in mechanical equilibrium, then that's zero. The net force is zero, which means that F1 to the right minus friction to the left. You just add up the forces. Positive to the right, negative to the left. They must be equal. If they're equal, is the block moving? What do you think? Very good. See, you guys are thinking already. Because before this class had started, I bet most of you would have said no. Because it doesn't seem right. There's no net force on the block. Of course it's not moving. Now we know mechanical equilibrium, when the net force is zero, just means there's no change in motion. Because Newton's first law tells us inertia would just keep it going. So this block could be going. Remember our car example? You're going 85 miles an hour. The car is propelling you somehow, but there's friction and wind resistance against you. But you're maintaining your speed. You're not changing your motion. So yeah, we can be moving along here at some velocity. But is that velocity changing? No. Because we're not changing our motion. It's staying constant. If you start pulling harder and this becomes bigger, what happens? You accelerate. There would now be a net force causing you to accelerate, change your motion, and you'd start picking up speed. And if you stopped pulling as much so that friction became bigger, what would happen? You'd decelerate, which really just means accelerate in that direction. That's why acceleration is a vector. You can accelerate that way or this way. If something's trying to accelerate you that way, the net force is that way. Yeah, and it'll decrease your velocity. Stay with me. You're still moving this way, but you're slowing down. You're going to have to start keeping velocity and acceleration separate. A lot of people get confused when you're looking at the problems. Just remember that. They're two different things. Remind yourself what they are. We've discussed velocity better. Acceleration, we've essentially defined, but let me make it formal. It's a change in velocity. And that's going to take a certain amount of time. I like doing this. So this is the Greek symbol delta, and it means change in. Delta, change in. So if there's your velocity is changing, getting bigger or smaller, then you've accelerated. It's a change in velocity. Another way to look at velocity and speed, how would you define those? V, what are you changing when you're going 55 miles an hour? What is changing? Think about it. You know it, just don't realize it. Distance, your position. So, you know, if you're so far in the x direction, then you're changing your x position. Distance with time. This one should make more sense. If you're going 55 miles an hour, that unit, miles per hour, that means you go 55 miles in every hour. Miles per hour. So a velocity is just a change in position. If your position's changing, then you have a velocity. If your velocity is changing, you have an acceleration.
What was that on the delta velocity?
Delta X. Change in position. We usually, in physics, use X's and Y's to denote a position horizontally or vertically. So that's why I chose X. My bad. No. I'm glad you asked. I mean, if you can't read what I'm writing, it's kind of pointless, isn't it? Thank you. Again, yeah, if I write something you don't know what it is, please ask. If I define, say something and you don't know what it means, ask. There's another force I want to tell you about. It's the support force, a normal force. There's two terms for it. Your book uses both. Let's use this for less confusion. This has weight. It's acting down, force down. Why doesn't it fall down?
Because
the table's in the way. So the table must be exerting an upward force on the disc so that there is no net force. It's in mechanical equilibrium. It's not changing its motion. It's not accelerating. So you start to make the connection. If it's not moving, there must be a resolution of forces on it, or none at all. But they add up to zero. So yes, there is a support force. To think about it, I do like how the author uses a spring. If I exert a force down on the spring, it compresses. So it's pushing back up on me. You can feel it. I can feel it. So there is a support force. That's also called a normal force, because in math, normal means perpendicular. So there's a normal force. If this is your surface, then it's straight up. If your surface is sloped, you have a ramp, and you put the block on here, this is still straight down, the weight. Gravity is accelerating it straight down, but we've put a ramp in the way. It doesn't move down. It slides down this way because this is also exerting a support force, just not straight up, at an angle. So the support force, the normal force, is always perpendicular to the surface. That's how it got the name normal. That's a really good observation. Let me draw it. Floor, table, puck. You can start getting in the habit now. If you're interested in the motion of a certain object, look at the forces on that object. There'll be other forces, but if they're acting on something else, they're going to try to make it move. So in this example, the earth is trying to move this down. The table says no, and so it pushes back up on it. Those are both acting on the disc, affecting its motion. So that's why I only brought those up. But, so you got weight and normal force. We're balanced. Those are both on the puck. But yes, absolutely. This has a certain weight down. And so it's pushing on the floor, and the floor pushes back up on it, and it's in equilibrium. This weight of this, you can either say, well, this is the force down total, including everything on the table, or the weight of the table plus the weight of this are both going down, and you would include that in this value. Thus, this has to support not only the table, but everything on top of it. But that's looking at the motion of the table. But they are there, absolutely.
But the reason why we don't have to really worry about it when we're talking about the puck is because it cancels out, right?
They do cancel, yeah. So vertically, this thing's in equilibrium. Whether it's sliding or not, it's not changing its motion vertically. And we will revisit this in Chapter 10 with projectile motion. Because you can have motion horizontally and vertically. It can move straight up and down, or it can move both. It's changing horizontally and vertically. And we solve them independently. So yeah, in this case, it's simple. Since we now realize that vertically, there's no change, we don't need to mess with them. We just looked at the horizontal ones to see if it was going to slide or not. And I recharged the battery, so get rid of friction. And there's no reason for it to slow down. It should just stay at a constant velocity. And it will until it runs into something, falls off the table, or the batteries die, and then friction comes back. So, when you stand on a scale, and normally I would jump up on the table now and stand on this. There we go. That's how they measure your weight. It's mg down. Well, it puts you in mechanical equilibrium and supports you with a normal force. How much does it require to keep you from moving down? How much weight does it have to support? Yours. So it exerts that amount of force up and tells you what it is. Your weight. That's how a scale works. But then, yes, both you and the scale are pushing on the table. The table supports that, and the floor, blah, blah. It continues. All right. There's a difference between instantaneous speed and average speed. And nothing complicated. Instantaneous speed is at any given exact moment. So, if this is moving along, it has a certain speed. And right now, it's going 55 miles an hour. Right now, it's still going 55 miles an hour. I'm making it up. So this guy's speed doesn't actually change. Let me show you that, shall we? That's why I set this up, so. This is the easy one, and the next one's harder. So starting here, 1,001, 1,002, 1,003, 1,004, high-tech 1,005, 1,006. That's enough. Can you see the dots okay? I got little flags, but I won't. If you can see them. What I want to emphasize is this is showing the change in position. It moved roughly a foot in a second, my second. And look, in the second, it went a foot. A foot. You get the idea. So it's not changing. It's not increasing or decreasing. We have a change in position over time. It's changing a foot every second. So we'd say the speed is a foot per second in this case. The velocity would be a foot per second that way. Now, let's look at acceleration. Is the velocity changing? No. It's a foot per second every second. So it's not changing. So that's zero. This tells us a lot. If that's not changing, then there's no acceleration, no net acceleration. And if there's no net acceleration, there's no net force. And if there's no net force, we're in a mechanical equilibrium. And if we're in mechanical equilibrium, that means all the forces acting on this must be balanced. Did you follow that? Be honest if you did. So let's switch to a different vehicle. And assuming I don't trip and fall on my face, this will be good. All right, we're going to start here. It goes faster, that's why I'm... 1,001, 1,002, 1,003, 1,004. Okay. All right, what can you tell me about this motion? Describe this cart's motion. What can we learn? Anything. It's accelerating, and you know that how?
We had some velocity. I don't know what it was. But at the end of the second, we're now going faster than we were here. So yeah, the velocity is changing. And so we do have an acceleration. There is a net force on this. there must be a force propelling it that way that's bigger than anything retarding. And that's the fan blowing in the air. So it is accelerating. There's a net force. We're not in mechanical equilibrium. It is accelerating. What would you say this guy's velocity was? That was a trick question. To emphasize what I seemed like I started 10 minutes ago, right? There's a difference. Instantaneous velocity is at any given point. So right here, it was going so fast. That would be an instantaneous speed. Right here, it was going faster. Instantaneous speed. But on the average throughout the trip, you would just take the whole distance. Let's say we went from there to there. It's 4 meters. And it took... abbreviating 4 seconds. So then 4 meters divided by 4 seconds, we went a meter per second. On average. What that means is if that was going at a constant speed of 4 meters per second, it would have taken the same amount of time. It would have started faster, but it wouldn't have speeded up. It wouldn't have accelerated. So an average velocity just kind of gives it over the whole trip. Over the whole change in position. Where instantaneous is like your speedometer, right? Tells you how fast you're going at that very moment, not over the whole trip. Sometimes you go slower, sometimes you go faster. I want to probe you. It's always different in every class. Algebra. This equation, which is our guide to thinking, do you see how it shows relationships? It helps us define acceleration. It's a change in velocity, a change in motion. And it's a nice shorthand way to show us that. You can rearrange it like this. Please tell me if that confuses anybody mathematically, because that's the basic algebra that I'm hoping you know how to do. And if you're embarrassed, you better contact me later, or you won't like this course, because we're going to be rearranging equations quite often. I just don't want this to people going, huh? They want to know now before I just keep doing it and lose people. So that'll come in handy. Because if the problem asks for this value, then you plug those two in and you got it. But if it asks for acceleration, you need to do it this way. We have standard units in physics. And the standard unit for velocity is meters per second. Meters per second. There's other units like miles per hour, but we use standard units, and that's the standard. So for acceleration, that would be, there's our velocity, but it's going to change every second. So another way to look at that is a meter per second, but we usually just write meter per second squared. Those are all the same thing, but I write it this way so you can see that. Okay, we're going 10 meters per second. Every second. We're going to change by 10 meters per second. Every second. I'm making up the number. That's roughly what it is for gravity. So that means in the first second, if you started at rest, you'd be going how fast? If the acceleration were 10, how fast are you going after the first second? 10, because you just changed by 10. How fast are you going after the second second? 20, because we changed 10 again. 10 plus 10. And here, 30, because we changed 10. That's what acceleration tells you. It tells you how much the velocity changes every second. So that's the unit. And lastly, force is newtons, the standard unit. Mass is in kilograms. Gravity is right here. Is that meters per second? And those two multiplied together happen so often, they give it the standard unit called a newton. A newton. So you could have 10 newtons of force, 200 newtons of force. Any questions? Well, don't forget about your homework. This is the first one, so don't wait till Sunday night to figure everything out. Well, I'll see you guys Monday, assuming I'm still alive.